Hi. By now, you've probably already heard from us about the amazing subscription deal The Washington Post is offering right now. And I wanted to give you another reminder because it's really such an incredible offer, and it won't be around much longer. 99 cents can get you 4 weeks of The Washington Post, including ad-free podcast listening, and that's a rate you can lock in for a full year. Plus, becoming a subscriber is one of the best ways to support our work. So if you haven't done it yet, hit pause and go to washingtonpost.com/subscribe or click the link in our show notes. And thank you. Here's today's show. Earlier this month, under pressure from the U.S., Israel opened a new crossing for aid trucks traveling to Gaza. But aid is not always getting in. Far-right Israeli activists are stepping up attacks on aid trucks bound for Gaza. In one video, you can see a group of young men stomping on boxes of food and smashing them on the ground.
What we've seen is these groups of young settlers setting up this very organized network of online groups, mostly run through WhatsApp groups, where they plan attacks on aid trucks traveling through the West Bank and going to Gaza.
Loveday Morris is in Jerusalem and reporting on the Israel-Gaza war for The Post. She traveled to the crossing to see what's happening there.
And you have people following these trucks on the road and then stopping them. That some people are setting up makeshift checkpoints, stopping them, asking them for documentation to prove they're not going to Gaza.
Loveday reports that this violence and vandalism raises questions about Israel's willingness to ensure that aid flows to Gaza. And she says that the right-wing Israeli settlers behind these attacks are doing so because they believe the aid is going to Hamas.
They say this food is going to feed Hamas, and they're feeding the enemy in wartime. And you hear a range of views from people on how much they care if that means that Gazans will starve or not. You know, some are in complete denial that there is any kind of famine or hunger happening in Gaza. They'll argue that the markets are full and there's no issue. And others would say they don't care.
International humanitarian groups say Gaza is sinking even deeper into famine. USAID head Samantha Power said conditions today are worse than ever. Israel moved into Rafah earlier this month, saying the offensive is necessary to eliminate the last Hamas battalions in the city. But more than 1 million Palestinians had been sheltering in the city in southern Gaza. And this Israeli military operation has further limited the ability to deliver aid. From the newsroom of The Washington Post, this is Post Reports. I'm Elahe Izadi. It's Thursday, May 30th. Today, how Gaza has reached one of its darkest points. My co-host Martine Powers talks with Loveday about this and why humanitarian aid has become so political. I'll let Martine take it from here.
So Loveday, I want to take a moment here to take stock of the situation in Rafah because it's all moving pretty quickly, and I think so many people have seen some very distressing images and video from this part of Gaza over the past few days. Can you just talk me through what has been happening in Rafah in the last few days and this latter part of this new Israeli offensive?
Yeah, well, certainly from talking to people in Rafah the last few days, and also, you know, from what my colleagues have gleaned, there seems to have been a significant increase in bombardment in urban areas of Rafah. You know, we've seen tanks move into populated areas. And these are areas actually that aren't under evacuation orders that they're moving into the edges of at the moment. So there's a real confusion among people as to whether they're meant to be leaving. They feel this fight coming closer to them. The bombardment's been really intense. And then we've had the incidents that everyone's heard about in the last few days, that really horrific.
The strikes, correct?
two yet on tented encampments, one in Mawasi and one on Sunday night that hit these shacks in Tal al-Sultan, and we had this really horrific fire there and 45 people were killed.
What has Israel said about these attacks?
I mean, they've said this was a strike that they carried out to kill two Hamas commanders that were connected to attacks in the West Bank who were in this area at the time. And they had said it was a tragic accident that it killed this many people. They are investigating why that happened. They're implying there was some kind of secondary blast and that there might have been weapons in the area.
And to be clear, they're saying that what they're implying there is that weapons that were not their weapons, that because...
Exactly. They're saying that their weapons couldn't have been responsible for an explosion this large. But weapons experts are saying sort of using any weaponry of that caliber in a camp like this, you know, is obviously highly risky. And when it comes to the potential for civilian casualties, the images and the accounts from the ground were horrific that evening, yeah.
One thing that I think is hard for us here in the States to wrap our heads around is the movement that's happening in this part of Gaza, because it's so many people who are being asked to move, you know, from one place to another to find safety. And I thought that there was supposed to be like a safe zone that people were brought to that was like outside the scope of where the Israeli military was targeting. So like, how does that work?
Actually, there is nothing even the Israeli military term as a safe zone in Gaza. They have something they call a humanitarian zone, which they say is safe, but we have seen strikes in that area also. And there is a lot of confusion as to where that is. When these strikes happened in Tal al-Sultan, a lot of people thought that was in this safer zone. But when the Israeli military dropped leaflets that expanded the humanitarian zone, the wording was very confusing for people. The language was a bit imprecise. And I mean, at the very least, this is an area where people haven't been told they should leave because of the offensive. So more of a kind of gray zone where, you know, the people from more dangerous zones have been told to go to the humanitarian zone, but people in this area have been told nothing. And some people actually thought it was part of the humanitarian zone. So there's a lot of confusion about these zones and also where to go. The humanitarian zone that is designated, I mean, you can't fit the entire population of Gaza in it. I mean, it's absolutely packed full of tents now. And there are so few services for people, you know, no sanitation. It's a really dire situation on that front.
And I mean, we've been talking about the strikes, and I think there is a fear that more strikes could come or what that would mean for casualties in Gaza. But also, you know, what has been the case for many months now is this fear of starvation and all the other ways in which people there are suffering. I know that there have been waves of efforts to try to get more aid into Gaza. And, you know, we talked about some of the things are preventing some of that aid from entering in terms of these attacks in the West Bank. But what is preventing more aid from getting in? And to what extent are there kind of successful attempts to, like, get in trucks with some of this food and some of these medical supplies for the people there?
Yeah, I mean, it's really baffling when you're sitting in Israel, which is, you know, a developed, plentiful country full of food. You know, Gaza is so close, you know. And you have the U.S. pier being built to ship in aid to one side of Gaza via the sea in this hugely expensive effort. When there is a gate, a five-minute drive across Gaza away that could just be open to let food trucks in, you know. And I mean, that's the hard thing to get your head around is why, you know, why this can't just happen, why this process can't be sped up, why there's food rotting on the Egyptian border. But I mean, humanitarian groups, I say it's just an onerous process getting stuff through the checking on one side. The Israelis blame it on aid groups not being able to pick up the aid on the other side. There is some of that. The Kerem Shalom crossing, where Israel has launched its Rafah offensive from that area, has become a really militarized area. So there's a lot of fighting that has taken place around the crossing. It's where there have been Israeli staging grounds around that area. So it's also become a target for Hamas rockets and attacks. So it's very difficult for distribution on the other side, even more than it was.
After the break, Loveday and Martine talk about the international investigations into whether Israel is committing war crimes in Gaza. We'll be right back.
Hey there, I'm Michael Shearer. I hate to tell you, but there's a blizzard coming your way. Candidates and their allies are projected to spend more than $10 billion on political advertising this election season. My job as a national political reporter at the Washington Post is to bring you the real story of what is going on behind that wall of political noise. Presidential elections are fantastically messy endeavors, a chance for Americans to figure out once again who we are and who we want to be. And the only way to do that well is for citizens to know what is really going on. This is the kind of work you support when you become a subscriber to The Washington Post. Right now, you can get full access to the best reporters in America for 99 cents every 4 weeks for an entire year. If you've thought about subscribing for a while, this is the time to finally sign up. Go to washingtonpost.com/subscribe. That's washingtonpost.com/subscribe.
So, Loveday, I want to talk about the international reaction to what we've been seeing, especially in Rafah these past few days. You have widespread outrage from foreign leaders. You have Spain and Ireland and Norway announcing that they are going to be recognizing Palestinian statehood in recognition of how horrible the situation is on the ground there. And then we have two different courts, the International Court of Justice and the International Criminal Court, that have also gotten involved in this. Can you explain a little bit what's happening in these court systems and what they have actually declared when it comes to Israel's actions in Gaza right now?
So at the ICJ, we've had the case lodged by South Africa with allegations that Israel is committing genocide in Gaza. And the ICC has had an ongoing investigation that goes back to 2014, but the prosecutor's office has just come out to say there is credible evidence to charge Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu, also his defense minister Yoav Gallant, and the Hamas leader Yahya Sinwar with war crimes and crimes against humanity.
Israel, like all states, has the right to defend its population. It has every right to ensure the return of hostages that have been criminally and callously taken. Those rights, however, do not absolve Israel of its obligations to comply with international humanitarian law. Intentionally causing death, starvation, injury, and suffering to the civilian population, including so very many women and children, are criminal means to achieve military and political goals. That's what we allege.
And what does that mean? I mean, particularly when it comes to an arrest warrant for a prime minister, how does that work?
Well, it's definitely not unprecedented. We've seen the ICC issue one for Putin. But the difference here is
For Vladimir Putin and Russia because of his role in Ukraine?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, Netanyahu, it's going to impact where he's able to go. So we've already had member states of the ICC saying they would have to act on that arrest warrant if Netanyahu was to travel to any of their territory. Putin, it probably affects, you know, less. He's less likely to kind of make the diplomatic rounds in states in Europe right now. But for Israel, yeah, I think it's something that bothers Netanyahu a lot more.
And what has Israel said in response to this, or Netanyahu himself? Like, what do they say about these accusations that he and that this country has engaged in war crimes, or that they might have committed genocide here?
Yeah, I mean, obviously, there's a huge rejection of those claims. The ICC warrants putting them on a par with Hamas. They've said these are anti-Semitically driven investigations and are completely baseless, the allegations of genocide. And they're lodging a war of self-defense after October the 7th. And they're doing it taking into account as much as they can civilian casualties. And I think there's a real sort of doubling down in Israel. I mean, there's been a lot of division over in Israel over a lot of things, including to do with this war. But people are pretty united in rejecting these allegations and feeling pretty isolated and alone and attacked by the international community.
Though I think it's important to be clear here that they really aren't isolated or alone in that the U.S. continues to be very supportive of Israel. We had President Biden call this arrest warrant for Netanyahu, quote, outrageous. Tell me a little bit about how the U.S. is navigating this moment and trying to stick by this ally, even as we see the situation on the ground in Gaza get worse and worse.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, the U.S. is also isolated in that way, you know, and standing in contrast to a lot of the world when it comes to really continuing to support Israel. Over the Rafah offensive, we've had Biden sort of issue these red lines and the White House reiterate them at various points about wanting to see a credible plan to protect civilians if there is going to be this operation. And at every stage, we've seen it progress, really. And now we're a month into a Rafah operation. I'm not sure anyone would argue there's much of a credible plan to move civilians to a safe place. We see tanks moving into neighborhoods where there are no evacuation orders, people with nowhere to go. And we've also seen just confirmed that the weapon used in that horrific strike on that camp on Sunday that killed 45 people was a U.S. weapon. And it puts the White House in a very difficult place when they've constantly said there are these red lines about over this operation in Rafah. But we heard from National Security spokesman John Kirby that they don't see a major operation underway.
We have not seen them smash into Rafah. We have not seen them go in with large units, large numbers of troops, in columns and formations, in some sort of coordinated maneuver against multiple targets on the ground. That is a major ground operation. We have not seen that.
But if you speak to people on the ground, if you talk to military analysts, if you look at where the tanks are and the troops are, I mean, and the level of bombardment we're seeing in central areas now, I mean, a lot of people are saying it seems like the White House is in denial. They're in a situation where they don't want to say their red lines have been crossed because it puts them in a difficult diplomatic situation with Israel, and we're just going towards an election. But military analysts who look at this would say it's hard to say there's not an offensive happening right now, and a major offensive.
Thinking back to the beginning of our conversation and your description of what you've seen and some of what's been reported of these attacks on aid trucks trying to go into Gaza, what do you make of the fact that at this point, just the idea of humanitarian aid has become so political, or that it's become so complicated in this situation?
Yes, although, I mean, throughout wars, we've seen starvation being used as a weapon of war. The big question is over this, is Israel doing it? And that's what these courts are trying to ascertain. Israel says it is absolutely not doing it and that it's doing everything it can to let aid in. But that is the big question, whether this is a tactic of war or whether aid isn't going in because of the complexities of the war and because of the difficulty in delivering aid during war. And those are exactly the kind of questions that these courts are looking at.
So as you continue to report on this in the next few weeks, what are you going to be looking out for? And what are your questions about how this is going to play out in the near-term future?
Maybe the long-term future. I mean, we just had Israel's national security advisor come out, Zaki Hanegbi, and say he sees this conflict in Gaza stretching to the end of the year, another 7 months. So now the focus is all on Rafah and the operation there. But really the question is, as it has been throughout this war, of what happens on the day after. And, you know, the questions for Israel right now are coming from their own government and from the U.S. Israel has said it doesn't want to run a military occupation in Gaza, but there seems to be no option that they're putting on the table for an alternative for that. So, yeah, there are big questions over sort of what's next, and there are big questions over how this military operation is going to be waged in this city, which was the last refuge for so many civilians in Gaza who really have nowhere to go, who are in a completely desperate situation. And that's getting worse by the day.
Loveday, thank you so much for sharing your reporting.
Thank you, Martine.
Loveday Morris has been covering the Israel-Gaza war. She's also the Berlin bureau chief for The Post, and she spoke with my co-host, Martine Powers. Before I sign off, here's a few other stories I'm watching today. A volcanic eruption in southwest Iceland started yesterday afternoon. This is the fifth time the volcano in Grindavik has erupted since December, but officials said this could be the fiercest eruption yet. The area is home to the Blue Lagoon Thermal Spa. If you've ever visited Iceland or seen pictures, you're probably familiar with this huge tourist attraction. Most area residents already evacuated months ago, but the eruption is spewing lava toward the town, and gas pollution could affect Iceland's capital city through this week. And the pandas are coming back. The National Zoo in Washington will get two new giant pandas, replacing the two that left last year, which ended an era at the zoo and broke a lot of people's hearts. This news was a surprise because China owns and leases all giant pandas in U.S. zoos, and there's a tense relationship right now between these two countries. In any event, Bao Li and Qing Bao will be coming to Washington later this year, which is exciting to many area residents and panda fanatics. Close listeners of the podcast know that I'm not one of those people, but hey, I'm really happy for the rest of you. That's it for Post Reports. Thanks for listening. Today's show was produced by Sabi Robinson. It was mixed by Sean Carter and edited by Lucy Perkins. Thanks also to Aaron Cunningham. I'm Elahe Izadi. We'll be back tomorrow with more stories from The Washington Post.